approve the agenda. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Motion.
Do I have a second?
I have Ms. Fallon. Second.
Second. Are there any questions?
All in favor of approving the agenda as presented, please say aye.
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 All those opposed, please say nay. Any abstentions? Motion carries.
Okay, recommend a motion to approve the following minutes. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Are there any questions?
All in favor of approving the minutes as presented on tonight's agenda, please say aye.
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 Opposed, please say nay. Any abstentions? That motion carries.
Okay, we have a couple of board presentations. I'll be beginning with staff recognition. Staff recognition? Yep.
We're gonna begin with that first staff recognition one that's hyperlinked on there.
here, right? This is our third time presenting data. We're really excited to share with you our journey. And to start our presentation, I wanted to read this quote that I read in an article just recently. And it said, next time you hear the phrase learning loss, think about whether we really want to define our students by their deficits instead of their potential. And I read this and it finally clicked. I said, this is exactly the mindset that we've had since we've had our students back 4 to 5 days a week in person, and we didn't realize it. We kept using a term that was coined by someone else, that it's learning loss, that they lost it, they lost it. We didn't lose through this. There was potential. And what we're about to show you tonight is the potential that our students had, and they rose to the occasion, that our teachers were there for them. We were able to bring back students at every opportunity we had to bring them back. Before we start, we're going to talk a little bit about our journey and some of the challenges, just so that way we can put it out there so you know what we've been doing. So we started off the summer with our Restart and Recovery Committee, and that involved many stakeholders, many people across the district coming together to be able to submit a plan to the Department of Education that was sound and obviously compliant with the COVID-19 restrictions and protocols, and working closely with the Ocean County Health Department to ensure that the safety of our students and staff was paramount, and that we were able to provide the best possible education to our community.
Yeah, so in turn, we really had to look at ways to optimize the schedules that our students had. So really looking at the schedules in order to really prepare the teachers and also the students for asynchronous and then synchronous learning opportunities, as well as that virtual piece. And so what we normally know in a year of a schedule had to really be sort of revised and revamped, and lots of different questions came up that we, you know, maybe didn't have the answers to, but we really worked together to problem solve. Are we sharing it?
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure they can see it.
And so the schedules really started in the summer and then really building into September and all of that preparation, and then finally we looked at ways that right from the beginning we started with hybrid instruction, really looking at 2 days a week for our learners, and then gradually increasing that over time until finally we got them back 4 days a week and then 5 days a week.
And then just some of the challenges at the bottom here, we have students, teachers, the class quarantines that we had to adhere to. We had teacher accommodations and leaves that we were able to accommodate. Student absenteeism was a huge issue, especially over in this building for our 3rd through 6th grade. And you know, despite Mr. Denning's effort to make that the school goal, we still saw a lot of students not attending virtual sessions. We had them not coming to school, so that was a serious concern. And throughout all this, our focus has been maintaining the continuity of a standards-based instructional model for our district.
So right now we're going to go through and start with our K-2 data highlights. I did have the pleasure of presenting this out to our K-2 staff this past week, and really looking at the celebrations that we can make from this. And I'll go through some charts. Some of them will be the same, but we'll kind of talk a little bit about the process that the teachers went through from the winter through the spring. So starting with kindergarten, we have here our Fontes and Pinnell reading levels. These are the instructional levels, and so this growth really shows from the fall all the way to the spring. The kindergarten students, as you know, did not take the FMP assessment in the fall, so we're looking at growth from the winter to the spring. And so we have students that have grown from the winter, 29% of those students were meeting or exceeding, and now we have 54% that are meeting and exceeding expectations. And so in turn, you can see the reduction from those students who were approaching grade level expectations. Now we have reduced that down to 21%, and then our at-risk students has also decreased. So these are things that we're celebrating because we've made the growth, and we know that this is something that we're going to be looking at for summer program and also into the fall. The following slides depict our AIMS web assessments. So we'll start with the early numeracy charts for you. So the green components, those are our low risk. So students who are low risk. Yellow are students who are moderate risk, so those are their approaching levels, and then the red is obviously the high risk of students, the ones who need the most support, the tier three. So from fall all the way to the spring, we can see the tremendous growth that has been made for our students in the green. And the bottom numbers really depict, you'll see like just the regular numbers, those are the number of students, and then in parentheses, that's the percentage. So chunk there. The 30% in tier three has reduced down to 13% for early numeracy for kinder. This chart is just another way of looking at it. So we showed something similar in the winter, but what these lines show, and they measure along the composite score that's depicted from, that we get from AIMSWeb, but the solid line is the George J. Mitchell School, and that dashed line is the national sample, so the compared against the national norm. And so we can see that our kindergarten students came in at the fall below that sample, really being compared against other national students, and has now surpassed the national norm. And so the amount of points that they've grown from the fall to the spring is really, really tremendous. So this just shows you that visual from fall, winter. So we would have looked at that for the winter and then again to the spring. And the same exact thing for literacy. So the early literacy composite, what you're seeing here, these composite scores are made from letter naming fluency and then letter word sound fluency. Our teachers worked very diligently during PLCs with AIMSWeb consultants to really master that progress monitoring process and look to see, okay, we have students who need to be progress monitored in letter word sound fluency. So they were really testing them every other week with probes specific to that and then providing intense interventions. So you can see the growth here. We have the tier one, so those low risk students, we have 64%, and that has increased from 25% in the fall. And then this is just an example of that same type of chart being compared to the national norm again. So we can kind of see how we do have that line that's going up, whereas the national norm is sort of like a little bit flatter. The points that we've gained from the winter to the spring, we've definitely closed the gap much more so than the winter. And it does give us a good depiction of really where they are and where we need to continue to work with them in first grade. These are our first grade students. So you can see here, we have the same type of chart, but you'll see now we're looking at 38% are meeting and exceeding expectations for instructional levels. We've reduced down that approaching very much so from the fall. And then we can see it's a little bit up from the spring, but we know that we also have an increase with the meeting exceeding and a reduction with the at-risk students for the spring. So everything sort of shifts based on how the students are growing. Our first grade AIMSWeb data shows here our early numeracy scores. So we have our students that have, I'm really just looking at that tier one again, 34% grown to 43%, and then finally 63% of students in the low risk. And really looking at how we've reduced the tier three from 45% down to 39%, and then finally to 28%. And when we look at this really like as a grade level, as a class level, when we work with teachers in our grade level meetings, we can use these things to really say, looking at the yellow, looking at the students who are in that sample of tier two, really, those are the ones that we try to optimize the progress monitoring process because we look for ways that we can really bring them into proficiency. And it all kind of like is a domino, but those are some of the things that we analyze from a grade level and a class level. This is again the line plot, so in comparison to the national norm. And so although we are below it, we have maintained steady progress and really continued that elevation with that line there. These are our literacy charts here for you. So tier one, we'll look at 46% are in the low risk, and that has grown from 28%. And we have those tier three students, so we're still looking at 46% that we know that we need to really hone in on. And so what I want to bring up with first grade, we have in the spring, the composite score is consistent just of oral reading fluency. And we know that there are lots of different skills that lead up to fluency. Fluency builds to comprehension, but before that, there is some sort of a breakdown as to why they are not able to read a passage or something fluently. And so they can't comprehend it. So our teachers really dove a little deeper into the winter data to really say, okay, we have to progress monitor a little bit before that. And so some of our teachers really looked at the nonsense word fluency at the word level, building up the automaticity with the coding. And so in turn, that really does build into the fluency. This is our growth before is consistent on the oral reading fluency. And then finally, we have our second grade FMP levels. They have really, really tremendously grown from the fall, the winter, and now the spring. So we have 53% of students who are meeting or exceeding grade level expectations. And then everything else has sort of just decreased. So our approaching levels have gone from 27% down to 25%. And then we've reduced down the 33% that were really showing up at risk, below level, down to 23%. And I just want to mention too, and I don't think I mentioned this before, but we have talked about this probably at the winter and the fall. As each period of benchmarking occurs, the expectations increase. And so what we were measuring in the fall, it's really not what we're measuring now. Everything really builds and increases. That's with AIMSOD, that's with Fontes and Pinnell, and even our 3-6 assessments with Linkit. And so, you know, the fact that our teachers and our students, they've really been working rigorously to really provide the best instruction for them. So I showed them these charts this week, and you know, you can see the green increase here as well. You can see they built it up to 66% that are low risk students. And they're closing the gaps. And we show them, like, this is your math. And then their reading was just phenomenal too. So we have less red, we have less yellow, and we have more green. So we're looking at growth. And this chart right here, you know, we look to say, like, from the fall to the spring, you made about almost like 66 points or so, whereas the national norm sample of students only made about 55. So we're like, that's really awesome. You know, like, amidst everything else, you were their support, you were their social emotional backbone sometimes. And amidst all that, you still instructed them and you gave them what they needed. So we celebrated.
We're going to talk about 3-6 grade data, and for the board in the folder that's there, we actually have a hard copy for you of this presentation, and then there's something we're going to reference, which I'll talk about. So in going with the FMP levels, you can see, and it's a slider scale, so looking across, you can see in third grade we were able to increase the meeting and exceeding from 23% to 40%. We reduced our at-risk from 46 to 38%, and then they kind of fall in between. So for our FMP levels, we saw some increase. With fourth grade, same thing. We have the increase on this side, we're decreasing on this side, and then sort of the middle falls in that the same. Fifth grade, a little bit more of a level off. We started off 38%, and again, like Elisa said, the rigor increases. So the expectations from fall for that level for an entering fifth grader, it's much higher now. So the rate of growth and the expectation, we look at that growth in a typical year. This is an atypical year, right? So for us to be able to maintain similar growth from the beginning to the end is still an achievement. It doesn't look like growth here, but students still moved levels for that grade level. So there was almost like a maintaining of what they had with those skill sets. Sixth grade, we saw a huge increase here. 19% in the fall, went up to 40%, and we decreased our at-risk from 55% to 32%. And for the FMP, we did talk about this in the fall and the winter, but it does encompass a variety of skills, which includes, you know, decoding and encoding of words, comprehension, retelling. All those skills are part of that assessment, and students have to be able to be reading fluently as well on those levels for them to advance to the next one. So when we look at the ELI, the Linkit data, there's a couple things that I just want to point out. We're looking at winter to spring because if you remember in the fall, we administered the previous grade levels assessment so that way we could see what skills were lacking. So while in some of the grade levels you're not seeing a huge gain, we have to remember that we started off working on skills in a previous grade level to fill that gap and now move into the current grade level. The other thing that we were able to do to make it a little bit more manageable for the teachers and for the students was we identified focus and power standards. And there's an example in your folder if you wanted to take a look at it either now or on your own time. But basically what the coaches were able to do was they were able to identify standards that the teachers were focusing on. We called them power standards. And the teachers were taking a look at those standards, they were teaching those standards explicitly, they pre-assessed, and then they did a post-assessment. So you can see while we focused on really important standards, this assessment is looking at every single standard that's in that grade level. So in third grade, we didn't see much gain. Fourth, fifth, and sixth grade for ELA, we only saw, and this is a percentage of students that are proficient on that end of grade level assessment. So while we're not seeing it in the overall score, we have to remember in this year we had hybrid instruction. We were able to get our third through sixth grade population back 5 days by spring break. K to two had a little bit more of an advantage. We were able to get the students back more quickly. So what we're going to do with this data is we analyze it with the teachers, we work in PLCs, and I'm gonna switch over to math so that way you can take a look here. We look at the standards where there are some gaps, and then that's our starting point. That's our entry point for next year. And also, and we're gonna talk a little bit about this, some of the programs that we're offering to be able to accelerate learning for these students. In math for our Linkit, we did see a little bit of a dip here. But remember, the rigor increases. Some of the other grade levels, we went up slightly, 21 to 26, 22 to 25, and then 17 to 20. The other thing that I'd like to mention is that we're looking at multiple measures. So we showed you the FMP level, which is important. It encompasses many skills. This is a grade level assessment of every single standard. So we have to look at a student, we have to look at the whole child and kind of look at exactly where the strengths and weaknesses are. And some students excel better in one subject area than the other. So I kind of touched upon this, but reflecting on our accomplishments, you know, we were able to provide in-person instruction from the onset. There were many districts that weren't afforded that opportunity, and while it was only 2 days a week, it was better than completely virtual. And every opportunity that came our way, we were able to bring back gradually more and more students safely. We started with our at-risk populations, basic skills, special education, 504s. They were all brought back as soon as we possibly could. And then you saw as we gradually increased the number of days of instruction for students, and at this point, we're 5 days a week, full days in person. So we had the in-person instruction.
And then from there, we did sort of mention this as well, but you know, we really really pride ourselves with really being able to provide the job and PD. You know, we have the opportunities here. We are able to really support teachers with what they need, and we want to really empower them to collaborate.
Being able
process to make sure, as you know, one of the indicators in QSAC is INRS, our procedures. So they just help us kind of look at our student population, make sure that we're providing the proper services and supports to students before requesting additional services or a child study team evaluation.
And then looking into the fall of 2021, these are just some things that we are going to be focusing on from a district level. So really continuing with data-driven instruction, looking at the spring data, looking at what we come up with in the fall. And then ultimately even looking at the students who attend the summer program, you know, what were we able to get from that in terms of the data-driven instruction. And then we really want to optimize our tier one interventions in the classroom. So are we properly differentiating? Are we properly providing students with targeted and strategic supports in the classroom to really make sure that the teachers are giving them what they need? And then from that point, now we can start to evaluate the tier two and tier three needs. With that comes with a student-centered coaching model. So all of the data analysis, all of the, you know, meetings that we have about data, we really want to kind of start to link the coaching model with that so that we can look at ways that we have classes that have maybe similar needs or similar strengths, and then use that to really have our literacy coach be able to really sort of like co-teach with a teacher based on the data and work with a teacher from like a unit start to a unit end. So really sort of shifting that to a student-centered approach.
And then our after-school programs and tutoring, which will be funded through our ESSER II grant. There was a learning acceleration component to that. So what we were able to do with that money is offer after-school programs, which would be STEAM and math clubs, book clubs, and then bringing back our drama club that would be funded. The other thing that we're doing is offering some after-school tutoring to students that are in our Orton-Gillingham tutoring program.
And then these are just some of the topics that we're going to be offering the teachers next year for professional development. So in line with the social-emotional learning comes the responsive classroom model, and really going back to, are we implementing the morning meeting really with fidelity, and what are all of the components so that we can start the day properly and really looking at the whole child before moving into some of the academics. We've mentioned it, but we have an RTI period in every grade level in the Broadcom building, and then we're looking to add it back in for grade two in the Mitchell School, so really providing the teachers with some follow-up professional development on the RTI model, because the last we did was February of 2020. So, you know, it's definitely time that we really look at that period again, make sure that we're using it to the best that we can. Trauma-informed practices is definitely going to be a topic we will be providing, small group instruction, and then, as we mentioned, some of the intervention programs that we use with the students, foundations and just words for some of our BSI students, we're going to be providing some PD on that as well. And then this is ongoing, but the job embedded PD with our coaches and consultants.
And then lastly, we have our Orton-Gillingham training, which we allowed for 11 teachers to be part of this, and it's a four-course sequence through Fairleigh Dickinson University, completely funded through the teacher's contract reimbursement, and then also through the learning loss grant that we received. And we're paying 100% of their coursework, books, materials, everything is included in that. And at the end, we'll have 11 teachers that are Orton-Gillingham certified, and they can use what they've learned in the classroom to enhance their small group instruction.
So I put this in here to end with another quote, but really, if you're positive, you'll see opportunities instead of obstacles. And I think, you know, as people and individuals, when this all happened, it's really hard to shift your mindset and not see things, certain things as obstacles, but I really believe in positivity and it's all about the mindset. So I'm really looking forward to a new school year, a fresh start, and you know, I hope that you see some of the positivity we shared tonight.
Thank you. Any questions?
You're focusing your power studies that were chosen for the EI, and then I guess they were chosen on via the data.
Yes.
Were they changed throughout the year, or?
So what happened, because we weren't able to do Linkit form, it's supposed to be A, B, C, we were only able to do B and C, because A, we opted for the previous grade level. So when we got our level B, or a form B data, we looked at where the biggest deficits were,
mm-hmm.
and the biggest opportunities, and then that's what was our power standard, and we progress monitored from B to C.
So you just did B to C on
yes.
the
Yeah, and that's what you see in the folder for the ELA and the math, those are the standards, and then that's the growth.
Looking forward, we'll definitely be looking at A, B, and C next year.
Yeah.
Sure.
The last slide you talked about proposing, I,
I don't know if I'm understanding it correctly. Proposing that to make classrooms level, is that proposing to make them leveled?
Where's that?
When you talked about having coaches come in to work with a classroom to have students of similar abilities.
No, like reading levels. So what we do is when students, not a whole class makeup, we're heterogeneously grouped. And then within that, what we do is we do pull students by reading level or by strategy. So you could be a level C reader or you could be a G reader. You might both need to work on inferring how the character's feeling.
Okay.
You're pulled together. So no, we don't level
classrooms.
No.
No.
And then I just wonder, have you looked at surrounding districts to see if our just lower than the national average is just our demographics?
It is. So it's funny, we were working with Barnegat, who uses Linkit, and we wanted to kind of see exactly where they were. But when you look at the norm data, it really depends on, like you said, it's nationwide, right?
Right.
So is there a possibility that we'll ever get to 100% proficiency? Probably not, because I don't know a school district that has 100% proficiency. But there's certainly a range that we have to look at that's what I would deem to be acceptable. You know, and that's what I had shared last time when you questioned it, where in previous years, you know, we teeter between anywhere from 50 as high as like 70%, one
right,
grade level. So really that's the range that we're sort of shooting for now. And then we're gonna set our goal again once we've, you know, been able to refine our instructional programs. But we are seeing growth. I just wish we weren't in the middle of a pandemic, because the programs we have are fantastic, the teachers are even better, and you know, we're finally starting to use standards the right way.
Any other
questions? Question.
Yeah.
Probably should know the answer on this, but are you accepting any volunteers from the community or from any volunteers for the summer program?
We would love to have volunteers.
I mean, you mentioned that the kids do need some downtime to go play or whatever.
Yeah. Just shoot me an email and we'll make sure.
Is that an offering? Have you solicited?
We have not. We started with, because right now we need to make sure we had certified staff for them, but now we've added on some parents.
I mean, if somebody can give, you know, 2 hours every Wednesday, I mean, it would be a help,
yeah,
right?
We would love any.
Maybe give a teacher a break or keep them teaching,
right,
instead of playing.
Yeah. But even working one-on-one with some students, I know that Erin would certainly take some additional support in her program. And if there are people that want to come and volunteer, we'll certainly take you up on that.
Anytime. We love volunteers. Seriously.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joan.
All right.
Thank you.
Next up we have Mrs. Jackie Choi for a little hip presentation.
Should have questions about this, about the actual HIV investigation process, because you are a part of it. So we're taking an opportunity tonight to review that process with you. I'm going to start off with the definition according to New Jersey Code. What is a HIV? And that's harassment, intimidation, and or bullying means any gesture, any written, verbal, or physical act, or any electronic communication as defined in NJSA 18A 37-14, whether it be a single incident or a series of incidents that, and then this is where the complex definition of what a HIV is comes into play. It has to meet these three criteria. So it has to be, one, reasonably perceived as being motivated by either any actual or perceived characteristic, such as race, color, religion, ancestry, national origin, gender, sexual orientation, gender identity, and expression, or a mental, physical, or sensory disability, or by any other distinguishing characteristic. And that really leaves it open to a lot. For instance, a student could be targeted because they're vegan. A student could be targeted because they are short. A student could be targeted for their weight. So those are all type of distinguishing characteristics that could fall into the definition of it being a HIV. It also has to take place on school property at any school-sponsored function, on a school bus, or off-school grounds. And thirdly, it has to substantially disrupt or interfere with the orderly operation of the school or the rights of other students. This is also, so the first component is one of the biggest reasons why something may not be a HIB, as well as number three, because it has to substantially disrupt and interfere with their education. And if a student, if a parent comes to us and has a concern, and we investigate it, and it doesn't bother the student that it happened to, it very well may not be a HIB, because it's not substantially disrupting their education. So, as well as that, it also has to meet at least one of these three things. A reasonable person should know under the circumstances that the act will have the effect of physically or emotionally harming a student or damaging the student's property or placing a student in reasonable fear of physical or emotional harm to his or her person or damage to his or her property. Or it has to have the effect of insulting or demeaning any student or group of students, or it has to create a hostile educational environment for the student by interfering with the student's education or by severely or pervasively causing physical or emotional harm to that student. But there's a lot of components that it has to actually meet in order for it to be a HIB. The actual process.
I'm sorry to butt in with a question.
That's okay.
This two slides ago, it was like must happen on school property or off school grounds. Could you clarify on that? Takes place
or
on school property
grounds?
Or off school grounds.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it doesn't necessarily have to take place on school property.
No, it doesn't. So that's why when we hear about things that might be happening electronically through text messaging on the weekends, if that affects school, for instance, a student might be afraid to get on the school bus. And if that's affecting school and they don't want to come to school anymore, then it might possibly be a HIB. It becomes something that we do have to investigate. So sometimes it does get complex, because there are sometimes neighborhood issues that happen.
Mm.
But if it trickles over into the educational day and the students learning and their right to have an education, then we can and we have to investigate it. We can discipline it as well.
Right back to the origin of the issue.
Yes. So it gets complex.
No matter where it is.
Well, that's
no matter where it is.
Yeah.
On an athletic field, in the neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
electronically.
It could be.
What if the other individual is not a student in the district?
We still have to investigate. We have to coordinate with the other. We've done this before. We have to coordinate with that other school district. I believe it was Barnegat or one of the districts. We coordinate with them, and their anti-bullying specialist and our anti-bullying specialist will. One of them will take the lead role on it. Typically, we like to, if the student is our victim, then we'll usually take the lead or vice versa. But we do coordinate, we interview. So it's rare, but it has happened before. We've had a student move out of Little Lake Harbor School District to another district, but still maintain like electronic communication that we had to investigate. In our school district, we make it very easy to initiate a HIB investigation to look at it. So a possible HIB can be reported by any staff member. It could be reported by a student. It could be reported by a parent, a substitute teacher, somebody visiting the school. Anybody can report one. And it can be submitted at any time using the links on our district webpage and our school webpage. It can also be submitted anonymously. We will still look into it. If it's too anonymous, like they're not telling us who the victim is, it's very difficult to investigate something like that. But they can choose to be anonymous. And we do encourage it if they feel that they need to do it that way. So that's what it looks like on our district page as well as our school page. On the school pages, it's red. You can't miss it. We also have additional information linked there as well. Our policy on harassment, intimidation, and bullying, as well as our student code of conduct, our state HIB self-assessment score, and how to interpret that. My contact information is on the district page, the school anti-bullying specialist, their contact information is on the school pages as well as mine. So this program, as soon as you submit it, is called HIPSTER. It goes directly to the administrator of that building where it occurred, and the HIP process begins. So a behavior occurs, and an employee finds out about it, or a parent of that learned behavior, and we need to quickly think, is this something that is a possible HIP? If it is, I'm going to explain that in a moment. If it's not, we don't just say no and forget about it. We monitor that situation. For instance, if something comes in through HIPSTER and it is clearly not a HIB type of offense or a HIB matter, we can reject it. We've had that before. Some people after hours will submit anything and everything into that. We get arguments amongst neighbors, adults, and they'll submit that to it. So we, just because it comes into HIPSTER doesn't mean we investigate it. We have to look at it. Sometimes it's clearly, the parent will even say, my student wasn't targeted, my child was not targeted because of a distinguishing characteristic, but this happened. Right away, we know that's not going to be a HIP, so we will still go ahead, and administration can still give consequences for those behaviors because it is a violation of our code of conduct. But we will monitor it just in case, because if during that investigation, if we find out it might be a HIP, we'll open it back up. And parents will be notified by administration depending upon the situation. If we do believe that it is something that needs to be investigated, this is the process. And again, this process is all, this is not dictated by Little Lake Harbor School District. This is dictated by law. So if a staff member is made aware of a possible bullying incident, they have to report it to the building principal or their designee within 24 hours of the incident. If it happens during the school day, they have to do it that day. But if they're made aware of it at a different time, they have to tell them the next day. Then the investigation is initiated by the principal or their designee within 1 day of that verbal report. The employee who's making that verbal report within 2 days has to put that report in writing. And because of HIPSTER, they submit it all electronically and it's all in there and stored for the investigator. The investigation is conducted by the school anti-bullying specialist in coordination with the principal or their designee. And the parents of both the possible victim and the offender are informed of the investigation and the process. The written investigation has to be completed within 10 school days. We continue to do this whole process through HIPSTER so that everything is documented in there. And after that investigation is completed, the anti-bullying specialist consults with the principal. They make a preliminary determination of whether it is a founded HIB or an unfounded HIB. Then it is forwarded to the chief school administrator, our superintendent, within two school days of that report being done. The superintendent reviews it as well, looks at all of the witness statements, any kind of information that the school anti-bullying specialist shares, and oftentimes there might be a further discussion about something. The superintendent can say, I noticed that you provided counseling for this student, I think you need to do it for that one too. So there is possibly some more additional discussion when the superintendent reviews it as well. She then passes it along to the Board of Education at their very next board meeting, and that's when you review them with her. After the Board of Ed meeting, if it is a founded HIB or an unfounded HIB, within 5 school days after the Board of Ed meeting, parents are notified in writing the findings of that investigation. If the parents do not accept those findings, they can appeal to the Board of Ed again. And if they do that, the Board of Ed has to conduct a hearing and executive session within 10 days of that request. So we have had that occasionally. So So after that appeal, the Board of Ed will then issue another written decision, which must either affirm the original decision, reject it, or modify it. If the parents still don't accept that, they have additional appeal options. They can appeal to the Commissioner of Education no later than 90 days after that Board of Ed decision. If they don't agree with the Commissioner of Ed, they can then go ahead and appeal to the Appellate Division of the Superior Court of New Jersey, or they can file a complaint or and with the Division of Civil Rights within 180 days of that occurrence. This is a slide I really want to emphasize, that even if an incident is determined to be an unfounded HIV, the behavior may very well still violate our school code of conduct, and consequences or remediation can be administered even if the incident is unfounded. So a lot of times we hear, youth have seen that the definition of a HIV is complex. There are many parts to it. However, a lot of people aren't aware of what legally we have to follow, and parents, kids, and sometimes even staff will use the term bullying loosely. And when you're looking at this definition, it's not a general term. It's a very specific term. So even though these behaviors, we'll call them bully-like if it winds up being unfounded, then it is it could very well be a violation of our code of conduct. And these students will often get consequences. You don't get more severe consequences if it's a HIV as opposed to a code of conduct. It really depends upon the behavior, the age level of the child, and other circumstances. We don't have a one-size-fits-all type of deal here. So I hope that clarifies it a little bit.
Yes, I hear.
Good. So again, thank you. I'm the district's HIV coordinator. Every district in the state of New Jersey has to have one. Every school in the state of New Jersey has to have an anti-bullying specialist. So these are our designated anti-bullying specialists. We are required to go through training every single year. We also have a school climate and safety committee, and parents are invited to be a part of that committee, and they are a part of that committee. So when you, in September, see that come out, you know, consider it. Okay, thank you.
Did you put this on the website, Jack? Presentation.
I will.
Yeah, good, because it's nice and clear. I think
I
you put the flow chart up, right? You put the flow chart up?
It's not up.
Okay.
Yet.
All right, thank you. That was great.
I have a question.
Thank you. Yes.
You know, I see the 2-day and then the 10-day
mm-hmm.
and then the 10-day after that.
I know.
And, you know, like some issues I would think would need immediate attention
and we can
and
do
immediate
that.
Investigation.
And we can do that. You bring up a very, because why would you want to wait possibly a month to
sure,
give consequences for our behavior?
To come to school or,
so we
or
actually,
disrupting their whole learning ability because of the issue that's in.
We actually have a situation right now, and this happens frequently, that even though the investigation for it being a possible HIV is not completed, we've already have gained enough information and facts to know that it's a violation of our school code of conduct. And we can go ahead with administration, give consequences. So we're not gonna wait 30 days to address that behavior.
Yeah, I mean, I understand everyone's innocent until proven guilty too, and there could be many sides to a story, and you could have to dig pretty deep to get to the beginning.
Sometimes.
But you would
be amazed. A lot of times our students are very truthful to us, which makes the process a lot easier. But you do have to dig sometimes. Some cases are more involved than others, and we want to get witnesses, especially when we have conflicting. And witnesses could be actual students. It could be videotape footage from the building, from the bus. We really do a lot of work to determine the behavior because, you know, we're elementary school. It is our goal not to severely punish students. It's to change behaviors. Is to get them on the right track so that as they are older, that they do make responsible decisions, you know, whether it deemed to be a HIV or a code of conduct violation. That's our goal. Our goal is to really support them and give them the support that they need so that their behaviors are acceptable.
Absolutely. I mean, a disciplinary act is definitely needed,
mm-hmm.
But I was more towards like just stopping the bleeding.
Yeah.
You know, before, you know, because I know it could be two children, and then this child has six friends, and then
yep.
before you know it, it's
their time.
10 on 10.
We'll change a bus seat right away. We'll change a bus route right away. There are things that we do immediately to diminish those behaviors right away.
And one other question.
Mm-hmm.
The middle school and high school, same program as the elementary level for the most part?
The same process?
Yeah.
Yes. The process is determined by law.
Gotcha.
All those days, the 10 days, 5 days.
Right, so Eagleswood and Tuckerton, everybody has the same process.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes, they do.
Thank you.
Good job, Jeff.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. GJM Students of the Month and the Frog Pond Elementary School Students of the Month are on a link on the agenda.
And we also have one of the students
know,
that had come tonight, so maybe we can. Do you want to stand up and tell us your name?
Vinny.
Vinny, do you know why you were selected as the student of the month?
No.
Are you a good student?
Yeah.
Are you nice to other people?
Who is your teacher?
Miss Mason.
So she must have thought you were pretty special to get student of the month. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
If it's okay honor. With mom, there's some cookies back there too for you and your brother, okay?
Okay.
I know they're not Frog Pond students yet, but I did get them a few trinkets for the meeting here.
Thank you, Mr. Denning. Future frogs, right?
We can do a picture too, right? We get back to the norm here.
Sure, why not?
Do a picture of Mr. Denning?
We called him. They said it's okay to go. So
of course,
that's
it's okay.
Excellent.
Yeah.
We're very happy to see you guys.
Quiet.
Yeah, yeah.
When I sneak out, really forget.
Yes, go ahead. Thank
you. Guys
want to
do a picture?
Sure.
Thank you. Mr. Denning, want to take a photo?
Sure, why not?
And that's
sorry, Denise.
It's in Saffron.
Yes. It's in Saffron on the back of his shirt.
Yeah.
So cute.
I could do that too, sure.
Why not?
Let's get back to normal here. Right here.
You just had a birthday too, right?
Yeah.
Come on,
yeah.
Come on, you want to get in as well? Here, don't be touchy, you can stand right in the front.
Wait.
While saying, now today you're coming in, tomorrow you're quarantined. your class needs to quarantine. And they had to make that adjustment immediately, quickly, and effectively. So this has been one of the most challenging years for educators in general, and I just would like to sincerely thank all of our teachers and support staff for everything that they did. And one little caveat to that, I met today informally with a bunch of teachers just to get some feedback of how their year went, what can we do in the future. And the one thing I realized today was not only did our Bass River teachers, who are now part of our school family, have to make the adjustment of COVID, they came to a whole new school district. And they really did an amazing job. They're happy, they're part of our school culture now. They rave about how they were welcomed with open arms. And I'm just so proud that they made that transition and in the middle of COVID. So just thank you to all of those groups. And to say to the board that in July 1st, what we say to our admin team, what we've been saying to our teachers, is a new beginning. So we're gonna rebuild and restart based on the data that you've seen and the wonderful staff that we have. So our summer's gonna be very busy. You're welcome to come in and see any of the programs that are happening. And we're looking forward to the upcoming school year. That's all I have.
Thank you. Residents forum, agenda items only. The Board of Education recognizes the value of public comment on educational issues. The board requests that the public respect a 3-minute time limit when commenting on agenda items as cited in policy number 0167. General public comment will occur later in the meeting. The number again is 646-558-8656.
See anybody in the Zoom community? Or is nobody in any of our public management? Not this time.
We'll move on to the board work session. Safe Return to School Plan public comment.
So the Safe Return to School Plan is a document that the NJDOE is asking us to put together as a requirement moving forward into the next school year. It is attached there. And really, this is just the opportunity for the board, or if anyone has any questions on that.
Is that the LEAP update?
Nope, it's...
No.
Okay, so there's another...
There was a link.
Yeah, there should be a link.
And I know I read the link, but I won't see it on the projector.
Not like it must have been ugly somehow. Well, I mean, I can always send you another copy of it if you want. John will fix
it.
And then you want to do the LEAP grant?
And it will be available in the district's website.
Yes,
as well.
Absolutely.
So, if you have comment, you can direct it to Dr. Cooley, myself, and Mr.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question with the Safe Return to School
sure.
Plan? So I know there's a in that, are we going to include anything with regards to, because I would love to say that quarantines are going to go away, but there's a good chance that students could get exposed if we have unvaccinated staff. What do we have written in there, and I can't pull it up to see if we do or not, a plan to accommodate students that are going to have to quarantine, or is it going to be based on the state statute that you have to take sick time and it's going to count as sick days? Because it's just going to be absences for students who, based on the change, I guess is my question, if you know.
So basically what we put in there for, it talks about wearing of masks, it talks about physical distancing, and what we put for most of those is masks will be worn in compliance with the NJDOA and NJDOA. Department of Health current regulations, because you know as well as I do, it's changing significantly like every month. So at the time that it occurs, we would have to see what the regulations are. So the plan doesn't ask specifically about quarantining and forms of instruction. It's more about the educational environment, contact tracing, screening, vaccinations, children with disabilities, and then ensuring continuity of the services we talked about. Supplemental supports, targeted interventions, all the things they talked about in the presentation tonight.
Okay, so are we going to track, are we currently tracking vaccinations among staff?
We can't. We can't say who's vaccinated, who isn't. I can...
I mean, not say
I,
that, but yeah, can't.
I can't ask who was vaccinated, who wasn't. I can voluntarily ask, and I did put a survey out in both districts.
So we can't ask staff to say that in order to be mask-free, you have to be vaccinated.
Well,
I'm trying to get,
yes, we could say that, but we can't ask for proof.
It would have to be the honor system because it's a HIPAA violation.
I had to submit mine.
Well, this is an elementary school district. It's a public school.
No, it's a public. I mean, it's for a public university, and all of our students and staff have to submit. If you choose to go to
the
school,
I think because it's not mandated.
It falls under higher ed.
The state is not mandating.
It's not mandating, but it's.
It's recommended that you get it, but it's not mandating that you get it.
I appreciate that, but like also too, it says that, you know, we are in a public school setting. To protect children should be our foremost thought.
Right. Again, the state is saying it's not mandated for a child or a teacher.
I'm not saying that they have to be mandated. I'm saying that if they aren't vaccinated, then mask up. Just
right,
the same thing in the hospital.
But that's what I'm saying. If it's not mandated, then you can't ask for it. You can't ask.
Right. We have to comply with what the state is saying because this plan is directly tied to our third round of ESSER funding. And the first part of submitting the plan is this. It's submitting and saving into the grant system. And then from there, we can work and use funds. If we don't comply with what is there, we could jeopardize our funds. And they're not mandating it, like Mrs. Senwer said. But right now, we can't require that.
And wearing a mask would definitely identify a person as not being vaccinated. And
it could be for religious reasons.
It could also fall under bullying.
Yes.
So if the governor said you can only take off your mask if you're vaccinated, then it would trickle down.
And he has not.
So.
But now, and who is our contact tracers in the district?
Our school nurses, along with the Department of Health.
So we don't have anyone else who's certified as contact tracer? No other administrator?
We don't need one. We have our school nurses do that with the Department of Health.
Some districts have additional.
Well, we're a part of the process, but the nurses... But the nurses are the ones that you know, directly contact the county, the Department of Health.
And once an issue happens, everybody along the line becomes a contact tracer.
Yeah.
Recommend a motion to
the LEAP grant update.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's all right. Since our last update, all three sections of the feasibility study continue to progress as expected. With regards to the demographic and racial analysis, this section is almost complete and ready to be sent to the other consultants for their review and use in formulating their respective sections. The demographer is still waiting on one piece of information and has been requested. As for the education analysis, data collection is complete and all the site visits have been conducted. We talked about our visit. Our last visit last month. Lastly, with regards to the financial analysis, the review of documents and data entry has been completed. Mr. Sia continues to follow up with various business administrators on outstanding questions about staffing, and we anticipate receiving a draft of the report in early to mid-June, and once it's received, our office will begin to work on putting all the sections together, editing and working on the overall conclusions and executive summaries. The report then goes back to the consultants for their final review and approval. Once that is complete, our office will conduct a quality control review of the report to ensure completeness and accuracy. And that update, when I say our office, that's coming from Vito Gagliari and Kerry Wright from Porzio Bromberg. It's not the business office. So guessing nicely, it's on the timeline we discussed, and we still expect a report by the end of July.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay, moving along. Recommend a motion to approve finance items A through AA. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Are there any questions?
Okay, this is a roll call vote. Dr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Key?
Yes.
Ms. Palin?
Yes.
Ms. Roth?
Yes.
Mr. Zimmerman?
Yes.
Ms. Semler?
Yes.
And Ms. Chinutsky? Motion carries.
Recommend a motion to approve facilities items A. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Motion.
Ms. Roth and Ms. Palin. Roll call vote, Dr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Key?
Yes.
Ms. Palin?
Yes.
Ms. Roth?
Yes.
Mr. Zimmerman?
Yes.
Ms. Semler?
Yes.
And Ms. Chinutsky?
Yes.
And motion carries.
Recommend a motion to approve technology items A and B. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Schneider?
Yes.
Mr. Key?
Yes.
Ms. Palin?
Yes.
Ms. Roth?
Yes.
Ms. Semler?
Yes.
Mr. Zimmerman?
Yes.
And Ms. Chernitz?
Yes.
The motion carries.
Is there any reasons? And then this informational items listed on the agenda. Recommend motion to approve personnel items A through K. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Can someone just explain the difference between, or the need also for the lead teachers and that coincide with the coaches in the same field? So like, right, we have academic coaches, right, in these, a lot of these areas, as well as the fact that we're paying stipends for lead teachers as well.
You want to
yeah, sure. So part of Title II, which is a grant fund that we get, is for teacher leadership. And so we allocate those specifically in the areas of technology and assessment. We have various programs that we use to help instruction. One of them happens to be at Bentham Exact Path over here. And so those lead teachers, because they're using it, they're able to help teachers and provide assistance to them with using that data as they're using it. With technology, they work closely with our technology coach to be able to provide PD opportunities. For instance, we were able to get additional teachers this year, Level 1 certified. And so those lead teachers that receive a stipend, right now it's $2,100 for the year. That's funded through our Title II grant.
Thank you.
I'm just looking for the roll call. Hang on. There we go. Dr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Key?
Yes.
Ms. Palin?
Yes.
Ms. Roth?
Yes.
Ms. Semler?
Yeah.
Mr. Zimmerman?
Yes.
Ms. Chernitsky? Motion carries.
Recommend a motion to approve harassment and intimidation and bullying items presented and discussed in the executive session. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Are there any questions?
So roll call vote. Dr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Key?
Yes.
Ms. Palin?
Yes.
Ms. Roth?
Yes.
Mr. Zimmerman?
Yes.
Ms. Semler?
Yes.
And Ms. Chernitsky?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Sorry, that must be hard.
I know. I think
I was crazy. I think I saw it.
Recommend a motion to approve policies and procedures, items A through H. Can I have a motion?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Are there any questions?
It's a roll call vote. Dr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Key?
Yes.
Ms. Palin?
Yes.
Ms. Roth?
Yes.
Mr. Zimmerman?
Yes.
Ms. Semler?
Yes.
And Ms. Chernitsky?
Yes.
The motion carries.
Informational items, the following items are being presented for informational purposes. Public comment. The floor is now open to members of the public. The Board of Education recognizes the value of public comment on educational issues. Request that each statement made by a participant is limited to 3 minutes, as cited in policy number 0167. There is a sign-in sheet located on the front and we have it here. Please sign in before you speak.
It looks like we still have the same number of participants in the Zoom call. Any members of the public here today?
Can I just ask a quick question?
Sure. Can I have your name?
Sure. Abby Martin.
Go ahead, Ms. Martin.
I was just wondering, the school library media specialist, is that a shared service that we are hiring somebody new to share amongst?
No, somebody in the vicinity has to have their school media cert. And let's just say, for example, it was Little Egg, they had it. So then Tuckerton, Pinelands, and Eagleswood could have just a person in there. And then that person that has the cert is basically serving as the certification for that area. And they could consult with each other and so forth, but there's no exchanging of money over it.
Okay, so it's just one person that's...
Yep, who has the cert,
so
John?
It's
here, right?
So we have our media specialist here, and what he does, he basically oversees, like there's a clerk that's in each media center, and because it's required by CUSAC to have one individual that has a media specialist certificate, what we do, because we're part of the same region, and a lot of our schools, like Tuckerton and Eagleswood, are very small, and they can't afford to hire their own media specialist. We provide services to be able to assist the clerk in the event that they needed services.
Okay. I was just wondering. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can I ask
Michael Wallace?
Michael Wallace? Go ahead, Mr. Wallace.
So it seems like we're trending in good directions as far as the masks and numbers and all that right now. Actually thrilled that it's humid so the kids can take their masks off and see each other for a week, you know, and some smiling faces. If the governor comes back and says, we're putting it on district to figure out whether you want to wear masks in the fall, how is that being determined?
He's
and
not going to say that.
I mean, if we don't.
Ocean County Health Department.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So if he were
the
to say.
The current executive order states that schools have to wear masks because those are the most at-risk population, as it reads, because they're unvaccinated. So I don't know that he will or not. I'm not in his mind, but
right.
that's where it currently stands on the executive order.
Well, we know that September is typically hot.
Right.
And if, you know, what he's saying now is that, you know, if it's hot or it's humid, they don't have to have them.
Right.
I'm hoping by then we have a little more clear direction. And, you know, as always, we'll look at the numbers. In general, we are very low. There's only a few cases in the county. We don't have immediate concerns here. I would say the biggest concern we've had recently is if a family had traveled and had to quarantine. So we're not seeing like COVID cases spiking or anything like that. So we are in a downward trend. You know, I'm hoping that we get more concrete direction from the state. I love seeing the kids' faces. They're so happy. The teachers are so happy. So we want it to stay like this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
But with that said, what's the difference with summer camp here? The summer camp is required, correct? So students who attend camp are going to have to wear masks.
So we're waiting for more direction with him, and where we're leaving it now is that if it's hot, you know, and, you know, maybe one classroom has air conditioning that's working really well, but then the other one doesn't, and then we have to say, well, you can take it off in this class, but if you go to this class, you have to put it back on. So we are looking for more direction, and, you know, as I've said before, we have a very strong group in Ocean County in terms of our superintendent consortium, and we're immediately emailing back and forth, and everyone's seeing the same frustration. You know, we're trying to follow the rules, and then we get a tweet, and it was around two or more direction.
So it won't be the decision of the school.
Right now, he is saying, make your administrative decision what's best for your environment.
But didn't he make a statement today at today's meeting?
And it ended the same way. So make your decision the best you can, you know, based on your educational environment.
Well, in that case, then
he's empowering us.
The best decision.
Then which way would we go?
That was the.
If we had the decision to make it either, you know, our choice, I think that the parent should choose whether they want their child to wear the mask or not. And if the parent wants their child to wear a mask because they feel safer, they let the school know. We make sure they wear their mask.
Is that good? Everybody like that?
I think that's pretty good.
That's pretty good.
The parents decide, you know, what you put comfortable for your child.
Thank you. Perfectly clear. Right
I'm
now,
not the governor.
Right now, though, right? That could change
and
next week, or
if it's related to school, then how would that change?
That's the answer,
it would
right?
be the same, and we would have to quarantine those that were in that.
But I mean, would that change your then mask policy? If a COVID case was traced back to school, would that change your mindset?
I don't know. We'd have to wait to see what happened. Like I said, we're not having any. The biggest concern we have right now is just people that are traveling.
I know. I just feel like your approach was very, very cautious prior to now, and that's why I'm just kidding.
I was cautious, and I always followed the governor's orders and the Department of Health. I did, you know, to the T, and now he is coming out and saying, use your judgment. So my judgment is I'm not seeing an influx in cases.
But it said not a question of influx of cases. It said under extreme heat conditions.
And humidity, and it just
is
in
it
here. My hair is puffing. It is humid in here, and it's
well,
hot.
And we have rooms without air.
And we have rooms
right
that it works, and some works better
and
than others.
Always, too.
Right. Right.
Dr. McCooley, with the mask on, so my dog is down. When you have your mask on, it I don't care, you know, it has to be 95 degrees and 98 degrees humidity. With a mask on all day, it's not healthy for the child. And I think, you know, if you look at Texas, you look at Florida, they've been wide open, you know, for almost a year. And I think you would look at those states with their population and see how many of those schools have spiked with COVID. Or cross-transfer. That, I mean, they're not seeing it.
Right. And we're always leaving the option up to the parent that if they want their child to wear their mask, then they have to wear their mask.
And as far as like liability falling on the school, being traced back to school, is that where you're going with that, Dr. Snyder?
Oh, that's a good point.
I thought that's what I got out of your question.
So off each other,
I thought you were going back to that.
I don't know. Is that a question?
I find it very difficult to.
It's very difficult to trace that. Right, to prove that.
Good question.
Any other
it's great to see the public.
Scott, Scott, you got anything to add?
I got nothing. Go ahead, thanks.
Board forum? Well, I would like to say congratulations actually to the staff on recognizing all the years of service that they've been either in Little Egg or another school district, the retirees. Thank you, John and Alyssa, and Lisa, is it Lisa? I'm
yeah,
sorry.
Lisa,
end of year assessments. Thank you, Jackie Trezolino, for the presentation, and congratulations to GJM and Frog Pond Students of the Month. I would also like to thank all the staff, the students, the families, we don't want to forget the bus company, the community, and our Board of Education for all their dedication during a very, very difficult year. Everyone worked so hard together, really, to make this year so successful for our students. Thank you, and I hope all of you have a safe and healthy summer.
Thanks, Dr.
Anybody else want to say anything?
I just want to say thank you to Mr. Vaughn, who's retiring. He's had all of my kids. We actually went to the Holocaust Museum in D.C. Because of him, but my daughters really wanted to see it, and we left all in tears. But and Mrs. Nielsen and Mrs. Majeski, all of my kids have had them and had wonderful experiences. So I just want to say thank you. And then I also want to say that anyone is interested in running for the board, I believe applications are due sometime in July.
July 24th.
So if you're interested in being involved, learning a lot more about what's involved in running a school, well, this has been the most educational experience or one of them of my lifetime. So,
Dr. Snyder, if I could say, if you have an interest in that, you can contact me and I'll send you to resources so you can get the application packet.
And if you're already a member, do you have to rerun?
Yes. Well, like
if your term is expiring,
up.
You have to put yourself back on the ballot.
Yeah.
I will just second Debbie's thank you to everyone. Everyone and all of you. And then, it's just great to see faces and smiles and... some normalcy back in here, so thank you.
No, we don't need the second.
Okay. We have a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
John,
that's a second.
All in favor of adjourning the meeting at 7:32 p.m., please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say nay. That motion carries. Meeting adjourned at 7:32. Reminder to the public, the next meeting of the Board of Education is not on that date.
In July, at some point.